So, this is the fourth Russian film, and what's just happened? Nicholas II had been persuaded by Sergei Bitter, and he reluctantly agreed to set up a national parliament, and he'd announced that in the October Manifesto of 1905. Well, this film, we're going to look at the 8 years after that, from 1906 to the outbreak of the First World War in 1914. Nicholas was very reluctant to set up the National Parliament and only did it begrudgingly. And pretty much as soon as he'd done it, regretted it. And he sacked Sergei Bitter in 1906. And just to make sure that everybody understood that the Tsar was still in charge of the country and that he didn't really want mere politicians to be making laws, and they wanted to make sure that everybody knew Russia was still an autocracy, he passed these things called the Fundamental Laws, which was kind of like a new constitution for Russia, really. And in essence, the Fundamental Laws said, no law gets made in this country unless I agree with it, unless I approve it. So he was telling the Duma and he was telling the country, look, you might think you've got some power, you might think you politicians can govern with me. Well, you can come up with your ideas, but and you can help make laws, but nothing's actually going to become law unless I say so. And this was very disappointing to a lot of liberals, especially when the first Duma was elected. Nicholas didn't like the politicians that had been elected to it. He didn't like the composition of the first Duma. You can look it up, exactly which political parties were elected, how many seats they won, all that kind of stuff. But when the first Duma was elected in 1905, he didn't like it and he dissolved it immediately. So much for democracy in Russia. When the second Duma was elected fairly soon afterwards, he didn't like that either. Dissolved that immediately. He then appointed a new prime minister, a man called Peter in English, Stolypin. Now, Stolypin's an interesting character. Stolypin was very loyal to the Tsar and he wanted to build loyalty to the Tsar. He wanted the regime to be stable, but he also realized things needed to change in order for the regime to be stable. So he did two big things. The first thing he did was that he changed the election laws, which is a polite way of saying, really, that he rigged the elections to ensure that they would produce a result and they would produce a kind of body of politicians that the Tsar would be prepared to work with. And that's exactly what happened. When the third Duma, the third parliament, was elected, it produced a much more moderate set of politicians who the Tsar was prepared to work with. And that Duma was relatively successful. It worked. It stayed and it sat as parliaments do in session for 4 years until 1911. So that was the first thing Stolypin did that was, fairly successful. The second thing he did was that he thought that the peasantry was still a big source, was still very frustrated and still a big source of potential rebellion against the Tsar. And he thought that it was essential for Russia to kind of deal with the peasant problem, the problem that they still felt that they didn't have enough land and that they still weren't producing enough food and that there were still regular food shortages and that they were still using fairly kind of backwards farming methods and that they weren't the kind of dynamic kind of economic force that he felt that they needed to be in Russia. So he did three things for the peasants. The first was that he cancelled their debt payments, which is a big thing. You would like to have your mortgage debt cancelled. It would leave you with much more money in your pocket. And with that money, the idea was that they could then invest maybe in new farming machinery or that they could maybe buy some more land and that they would be able to be more productive and more efficient. So that was one thing he did for the peasants. The other thing, the second thing he did, was he said that the government would help them move to new parts of the empire where there was uncultivated land, and the government would help them move there and that they could farm this land. And that was another thing he did, again, to try and make them produce more, make them more efficient. The third thing he did, what was the third thing he did? Ah, the third thing he did was he said that if enough peasants in a village voted to dissolve the mir, then they could do so. Now, the mir, I can't remember if I've mentioned this before, the mir was an ancient kind of institution in the countryside, the village commune. And the mir in most villages was responsible for deciding which families got which bits of land and what crops to sow and, you know, kind of making local decisions like that. But Stolypin felt that the mir was a big kind of obstacle to the peasants modernizing and progressing. He felt that they didn't encourage new agricultural methods. And that it was kind of a break on the peasantry, and he wanted to break the stranglehold, as he saw it, of the mir on the countryside. But he didn't want to impose that from government because he thought that might cause too much trouble. So instead he empowered peasants and villages to make that decision for themselves if they wanted to. The thing with he made all these kind of reforms in 1906. He himself said that these reforms would take 20 years to work in order to produce a more efficient and a more dynamic peasantry. But he himself only had another 5 years to live. He was assassinated in 1911 by political radicals who felt that he was too repressive, and people who felt that by rigging the election laws that he had denied Russia the real opportunity to become the properly democratic country than it might otherwise become. So he didn't get the 20 years that he thought that his reforms needed to be successful, and the country didn't get 20 years either, because in 1914 the First World War broke out and Russia got drawn into that. However, on the eve of the First World War, Russia was arguably in a much better state than it had been 10 years earlier. The Tsar's family, the Romanovs, celebrated their 300th anniversary on the throne in 1913, and there were huge national celebrations and lots of patriotism. And lots of positivity towards the Tsar, lots of flag waving as the royal family came out and, you know, waved at their loyal subjects. The third Duma had sat until 1911. The fourth Duma had been elected in 1912, I think, and was still sitting in session. Some peasants had taken up Stolypin's invitation to dissolve the mir and to move to new parts of the country, and Russia was still continuing to industrialize. So there's kind of an optimistic view that in 1914 Russia might have been able to continue progressing in that way and have avoided the revolutions that came about just because of the catastrophe of the First World War. However, there's a more pessimistic view as well, that even regardless of the First World War, even if the First World War hadn't intervened, that Russia was bound to have some big explosive revolution at some point in the future, because the Tsar wasn't really properly prepared to grant people the democracy that they wanted. He nobbled the election laws. He and Stolypin had rigged the election laws. Not that many peasants had taken up Stolypin's invitation. The workers were still living in appalling conditions, and therefore that the ground was still kind of ripe for radicals to come along and whip people up into a frenzy and encourage them to kind of revolt against the Tsar and against the regime. So there are two kind of points of view, really, about Russia in 1914. There's the so-called optimistic point of view, that Russia could have progressed and democratized and modernized. And there's the pessimistic view that there was always going to be some kind of explosive or maybe even catastrophic overthrow of the regime and perhaps replacing it with something else. That's the situation that Russia was in on the verge of the First World War. What we do know is that the First World War had a horrendous impact on Russia, and it produced two revolutions in 1917. And that will be the subject of the next film.